Hey, what's going on, guys? John here. I'm in New York City right now. Look at that building behind me, that white building. That white building is called 740 Park Avenue. Look at it again. It has the highest concentration of billionaires in the entire world in one building. People like Barbara Streisand rejected. High-end celebrities, high net worth individuals, billionaires even rejected by the board. You just show not only $100 million liquid net worth just to enter the building, but there's so many other requirements to get approved.
When you buy a property here, you're unable to get a mortgage on the property. So you show $100 million liquid net worth, and then when you buy your apartment for $20, $30, $50, $100 million, you have to pay all cash, no mortgage. And many would ask, why would you pay all cash when you could use some of that money to further invest into other assets? Well, at this building, if you're at that stage in life where you need the extra cash to invest in other assets, then this building is not for you. Residents must also be willing to shell out vast sums of money. Maintenance fees can be as much as $10,000 every single month. And in 1990, residents paid on average $250,000 per unit just to repair the exterior facade of the building. This is 30 years ago. It was $250,000 a year. Imagine what it is today.
Steven Schwarzman, whom I'm a huge fan of, he bought John D Rockefellers Unit, which is the triplex right up top there, for $30 million in 2000, so 20 years ago. Now it's estimated worth over $120 million just for that triplex, 20,000 square feet. Imagine buying John D. Rockefeller's unit, just so much history, just incredible. And he's the co-founder of Blackstone. It was a private equity firm. They do real estate investing and leverage buyouts, meaning they'll buy companies and reposition those companies for huge profits and leverage other investors' money to get themselves into the deal. They'll use investors' money and banks to fund these deals, and they get huge returns, multi-billion dollar returns. I mean, this guy's worth over $20 billion, and he owns the largest position in real estate in the country. In the last market crash, he jumped in. He has a guy named Jonathan Gray on the team who spearheaded the real estate division, jumped in buying all these undervalued assets all through America. He started in Philadelphia. His dad owns a linen company, and it's called Schwarzman's Linen, and he wanted to scale it. He was a young kid, probably 15 years old, saying, you should scale this nationally. And his dad's like, no, we have enough. We have the house, we have a car, we have two cars, we go on vacation, this is enough. And Steven's ambition was much more than that. He co-founded Blackstone, which now owns the most real estate in America. When he was 29 years old, he negotiated the deal between Tropicana Foods and Beatrice Foods for $490 million. Imagine negotiating a $500 million deal when you're not even 30 years old. Just absolutely incredible.
This building is not without its fair share of controversy. There are countless strikes and protests and scandals associated with this building, with employees and people pursuing Wall Street, blaming Wall Street for all of the damages that have been felt throughout the economy. In 2011, a few of the residents have been subject to these tabloid scandals, and the riots out front have just been incredible. And they are pursuing these owners because the owners are worth, you know, many, many billions of dollars, making hundreds of millions of dollars per year, if not billions of dollars per year, whereas many of their hundreds of thousands of employees are making minimum wage or just above minimum wage. This building has 31 units. I'm going to speak about 10 of the most prominent owners in this building, talk about what they do, who they are, how they made their money. And why I'm doing this is to help everyone kind of see the bigger picture of what the similarities are between all of these wealthy elites versus what everyone else is doing. And I think this is ultimately going to paint a very healthy picture of how to grow tremendous wealth and what you should be doing and how you should be seeing things to hopefully emulate some of this success. First is William Zeckendorf and his wife, Lee. They paid $27 million for the 17th story apartment at 740 Park Avenue in 2011, so 9 years ago. I read his book a year and a half ago, and it's an autobiography. of the man who played a real-life game of Monopoly and won the largest real estate empire in history. It was a really good read. I would highly recommend reading it. One of the least successful people inside of this building is Vera Wang, with a net worth of over $500 million. She's best known for her iconic wedding collection and her red carpet designs. She's dressed people from Michelle Obama to Ariana Grande and everyone in between. She got her start in fashion straight out of college, becoming the youngest editor for Vogue, where she stayed for over 17 years. Then she later worked and designed for Ralph Lauren before finding her own bridal boutique in 1990, so 30 years ago. And Zales, Kohl's, David's Bridal, they all license her brand. And she purchased Jackie Kennedy's old childhood home at 740 Park Avenue. David Koch and his brother Charles Koch, they run Koch Industries. David paid $17 million for an 18-room duplex. Him paying $17 million would be like the average person spending $3 or $2. This is next to nothing to him. He runs this business. His business is the second largest private U.S. firm with revenues over $110 billion per year. They specialize in crude oil, fertilizer, Dixie cups, toilet paper, and everything in between. They employ hundreds and hundreds of thousands of workers. And he is well known for his philanthropy. He's given away over $1.3 billion to institutions like New York, Lincoln Center, Memorial, Sloan, Kettering. In 1980, Koch ran as the Libertarian Party's vice presidential candidate. And he only received 1% of the vote with Ed Clark. So then what he did was he began investing heavily into politics, people that instilled his views. So rather than him being the front on the front lines, he had someone else basically go do all of his dirty work. And he simply just footed the bill. And as he would make his investments, they would owe favors back to him. And it was just his way of further gaining control and being the man behind the curtain. I read his brother Charles' book, Good Profits, which I recommend. It was actually a pretty good read. John Thane went to Harvard University. He was the CEO of the New York Stock Exchange from January 2004 to December 2007. Went on to work at Merrill Lynch, where he received a $15 million signing bonus and a salary of $50 million per year. And that salary could go all the way up to $120 million per year. Thomas Tisch of the Tisch family bought the Eisenhower apartment for $15 million 20 years ago. He is the director of Sears Holding Corporation and Brown University trustee, among many other titles. Howard Marks is an American investor and writer. He's a co-founder and co-chairman of Oak Tree Capital Management, the largest investor in distressed securities in the world. In 2019, with a net worth of over $2 billion, he was ranked 370th on the Forbes 400 throughout all of America. So he was number 370th richest person in America. David Ganick is a hedge fund manager, paid $19 million for his duplex, the home of Jackie O in 2005. The apartment's currently on the market for $32.5 million, down from a $44 million list price. He owned a $4 billion hedge fund that was accused of insider trading that has been tied up in massive litigation from 2011 to 2018, doing tremendous damage to himself, his company, and his reputation. Izzy Englander is a billionaire and founder of Millennium Partners. He purchased this duplex from France in 2014 in a bidding war. He paid $70 million for his location, his duplex, $22 million over the asking price. That is absurd. $22 million over asking. It's worth an estimated $95 million today. And Jonathan Sobel, an investor and former partner at Goldman Sachs, paid $19.25 million for a duplex apartment in 2012 when prices were relatively low. And hedge fund billionaire Charles Stevenson paid $9 million for his apartment, served as the president of the building's co-op. What we can gain and what we can learn from all of the owners in this building is that they thought, or their families thought, very big, very long-term, and they were not looking for short-term gains. For example, Steven Schwarzman has been working at this for 35 years, as well as many other people. Vera Wang, she's been working very hard inside one profession for many, many decades. And that's why when I see everyone speaking about get rich quick and making a quick buck, you never really see those people at great heights, you know, a year, 2 years, 3 years later. They're fly-by-night operations that don't last. So as we step into a down market, this is the time to learn and ask yourself how you can create enough value for the marketplace to where you can deserve the lifestyle that you want. Thanks so much for watching. Please like, comment, and subscribe.